So Mel here from the Ebenscape. Thank you guys who subscribe to my
Hello,
channel.
hello.
I'm just I want to do a deep analysis, not too deep, into the rise in black racialized horror. I would say it started with Get Out, and then it went into the likes of Watchmen and Lovecraft Country and His House and Antebellum. And I'm wondering if this isn't too much, if this is what we want when we say we want to see more black people in speculative fiction. This is probably not what we mean. And using black trauma and interweaving that with the supernatural or the science fiction, and then using it to torment black people. I mean, there's long been criticism about the number of black oppression movies that have been made. Everything from all those slave movies that Hollywood loves, those black people crying, suffering type narratives, and the way that many black people are frustrated with those. Yes, oppression and racism have been part of our history, but it doesn't mean every single movie, TV show that gets made needs to be about these things. And the market, at least when it comes to black entertainment, black films and television shows, have been oversaturated by this narrative of slavery and racialized horror and oppression. So we want to move on from this. We want to see fun stories about black people in futuristic worlds where it's not simply about being oppressed, being victims. And a lot of this racialized horror stuff has been, well, it has been doing that. It's been taking black trauma, everything from slavery to segregation to Jim Crow, and weaving a narrative out of that with the supernatural, the science fiction, the fantasy. And this has given birth to a new type of horror, or racialized science fiction supernatural horror. I haven't coined a phrase for this yet, but it started with Get Out, which was a great film. For those who haven't seen it, it's about a young black man who visits the home of his white girlfriend in upstate New York, only to discover that the only black people around him are acting very strange. And once the truth is revealed, it's a nightmare for him, and well, he has to get out. And then we move to things like Watchmen, which again I loved, about it's a sequel to the Alan Moore graphic novel of the same name, Watchmen, except this time it takes place in an alternate United States, where not a world where slavery never ended, but a world where there's a lot of where the Klan is still prominent and represent the real threat to the society, which of course is not even all that far off, since according to the FBI, the number one threat faced in America is in fact right-wing terrorism. White supremacists and right-wing militias represent the number one threat for Americans in the year 2020, and this will likely remain unchanged. So Watchmen is very much on point in making this right-wing threat the main threat in the series. But of course that has a lot of implications for black people. There were some tough episodes in Watchmen. It tackled Tulsa, Oklahoma, the Tulsa massacre. For years they were calling it a riot, but it's actually a massacre, since the black people were the victims of this. And like many of these massacres, these racialized massacres, it started when, would you guess it, a black man was accused of sexually assaulting a white woman, which was never proven, but that ultimately led to thousands of black people losing their lives, their livelihood, their homes. And this was tackled really well in Watchmen. It was woven into the narrative very well. There were some tough episodes in Watchmen, chiefly the one about the young grandfather, the grandfather as a young man, and the fact that he walked around with a noose around his neck, and that gave a reimagined backstory to a very popular but mysterious character from the graphic novels. And I don't want to get too much into that. I don't want to spoil that, but I do recommend watching Watchmen. And it did a great job. But then we moved away from Get Out and Watchmen, and there are only so many we can take. To some extent, there was season one of Luke Cage, which also tackled this type of narrative where we had the superhero who is invincible to bullets, and a black man invincible to bullets at a time when black Americans are protesting basically the execution of black people at the hands of the police and other police-affiliated groups, whether they're former policemen or basically independent militias. And then you have that, but and that was again okay. And I was fine with Get Out, I was fine with Watchmen. I love both. And then we moved into this year where we have Lovecraft Country, which I really wanted to love, but just could not for two reasons. One is it's not very Lovecraft at all, and two, well, there are so many issues with that show that I don't even want to get into it. It would require an entire video by itself to discuss all my problems with Lovecraft. I didn't hate it, but I didn't love it as much as I wanted to. But guess what? Lovecraft Country also visited Tulsa, Oklahoma. And by that point, I just thought to myself, this is unnecessary. Did they not see Watchmen? Watchmen already did Tulsa very, very well, so why did they need to do it? And what's more, it felt so very plot convenient. I mean, they could have gone back any time to retrieve that book of names and or shadows. Is it a book of shadows or a book of names? But they could have gone back any point in time to retrieve that book, and they chose to do so on the night of the Tulsa massacre. It was just very, very plot convenient. I mean, why not go back 2 days prior? I read a solid portion of Lovecraft Country, and I like the book, and I like what the show was trying to do. I like that it was trying to, you know, I like the references to not just Lovecraft, but Edgar Rice Burroughs and numerous other classic science fiction authors. And I like this idea of putting black people in the midst of these stories and subverting these stories and authors' works. And these authors, like Lovecraft and Edgar Rice Burroughs, were very racist, very white supremacist. You can look that up for yourself. I mean, Edgar Rice Burroughs is probably best known for the Tarzan series. He is the godfather of the mighty white man trope. The Tarzan series, the Barsoomian series, which I actually like, A Princess of Mars, was featured heavily in Lovecraft Country. And of course, Lovecraft himself, H.P. Lovecraft, who was infamous for his racism that was not only featured prominently in his work, but in his real life correspondence and interactions. Again, you can look that up. And a word of advice, maybe I'm going to tell you don't do this, but don't query the name of Lovecraft's famous pet cat. What is the name of Lovecraft's cat? Or what was the name of Lovecraft's cat? You don't want to do that. But yes, so Lovecraft exactly wasn't. So I like the idea of subverting a lot of these racist authors, classic science fiction authors who were very, very racist. But Lovecraft Country, I don't know, the pacing was very fast. There was a lot dumped on you. There was a lot of things to decipher in any given episode. The plot was hard to follow. It was a bit on the nose for me. And again, I don't know. Tulsa for me was the like, did we need this again? Watchmen did such a great job. There was no need for this. And I just felt a lot of Lovecraft Country. Maybe it was just too many things dumped into the story that it was sometimes hard and confusing to follow, to the point where I usually had to look up analyses of the episode to see what I missed. There were a lot of historical stuff dumped in, a lot of Black American history dumped in that many people missed. Everything from the background posters to the spoken word narrations. They've used everyone from James Baldwin to other even more modern Black activist types. A lot of it was, I didn't say I hate it, but it just felt over the top. And I just thought it was just too much. And I guess you could watch the show maybe without focusing on everything that was going on in the background and wondering if everything had specific meaning. But I felt that the narrative was simply too much. And there's only so much Black trauma you can watch. I won't get into Antebellum. I've seen so many reviews that already exist, and I don't want to get into the twist there. But basically, Janelle Monáe plays a modern woman who finds herself on a plantation, and at first glance, it appears to be Octavia Butler's kindred, but it's not. At least it's maybe a Black Mirror version of Octavia Butler's kindred, which makes more sense. And I've seen science fiction do this much better. In fact, I'm thinking of two Star Trek episodes in particular. The Star Trek episode, Inner Light, with Picard, and the Star Trek Voyager episode, I think it's called Memorial. And both have done a better job with this kind of concept. And this is what I mean about where we're not using real life people, places, and events, just like they're science fiction allegorical versions of showing trauma and the ways that science fiction can introduce you, can put a new spin on that trauma. Antebellum attempts to do this, but again, it was so on the nose, it was so in your face. And Janelle Monáe has this thing where she has such a strong real life personality that it's nearly impossible for you to not see Janelle Monáe in this role. You look at her and you're seeing Janelle Monáe's personality, which makes it a little bit harder because she is looking at you and she's saying, "See me." But again, Antebellum, I wanted to love this because again, I give all of these movies a chance. I wanted to love Antebellum because I love Janelle Monáe. I really do. And I just couldn't because again, it was so on the nose. It was so in your face, and it was, this is not what we want science fiction to be doing. We don't want it to be just giving us racialized Black trauma. Do something different with this narrative. And it's weird because I once encountered a Black writer who attempted to do something similar, and I know there is a difference between what is known as a kind of idea science fiction, where it's not so much that it's realistic, but more so that it's about the idea itself. And we see, and a lot of science fiction is this way. It's not about how realistic it is, it's about the message that they're trying to get out. No pun intended with that one. But I'm thinking of movies like the Purge movies, where obviously that's not very realistic and would never realistically happen. But really, it was designed to highlight economic disparities, socioeconomic disparities among people. And that was the point. And in a way, I think Antebellum was doing that, where it's meant to highlight something about slavery, but there is nothing about slavery that we don't already know. So I'm not sure what the purpose of Antebellum was. And going back to this young black writer that I was thinking of, who had a similar concept where it wasn't realistic at all. And if you were to go at it from, like, how does this happen? How does this happen? Can you explain this? It would make no sense. But that wasn't the point. The point was to highlight something about race and racism, some truth about race and racism. Antebellum failed to do that because it didn't tell us anything we didn't already know. Which is a kind of international flavored version of this, about an immigrant couple that was put into one of those council houses in Britain, and the horrors of that comes to light. And this was clearly a take on the immigration issues facing Britain, where we have scores of people from developing world, non-white people from the developing world that are coming into Europe, and Europe not wanting them, but then feeling obligated to do something with them. And then we get something like his house. And I don't want to spoil that. That's the one I've seen most recently. And that's the one that I suppose that I didn't hate this one, but again, I keep asking myself why. And I know I feel like a broken record because I keep saying it's so on the nose, it's so on the nose, and what's wrong with that? You know, I've had this discussion about the problems with allegories, and this was going back to Star Trek. Shocked to find out that Star Trek had so many right-wing fans, and many Star Trek vloggers attempted to delve into why there were so many right-wingers who love Star Trek, and the deep dive led to some serious revelations. Is that and one is that basically Star Trek has never been as liberal or as woke as people wanted it to be, and this has allowed for right-wingers to safely kind of love the series without necessarily getting a lot of the messages about race and acceptance and blah blah blah, because a lot of it was done allegorically. Star Trek, again, never used real world races. The villains were always the alien other, and they were the ones who were racist and misogynistic and xenophobic and blah blah blah. It was never the humans. So that allowed many people to disassociate the message from themselves. The humans, especially the ones who were white men, were the good guys. It was the aliens who were the bad guys. And the argument is that because of this allegorical version approach to messaging, many right-wingers didn't get it. They didn't get these messages because they could again disassociate themselves from the message. They're not aliens, and the people who were the good guys looked like them. So, going back to the problem with why I have such a problem with things that are on the nose, I feel that I understand that, you know, to some extent, and I'm not being egotistic here because I am a news and politics junkie, but I will say that I'm probably more informed than the average person, in terms of paying attention to history, to news to politics, that kind of stuff. And the problem for things being on the nose for me is it's the, and I don't think it's just me, because again, I've seen many black people throughout the years complain about why is it that Hollywood is so obsessed with telling stories about victimized black people, black oppression, black trauma, and why is it we just can't get fun stories? You know, why can't we just get fun stories about us having fun in space? And I've even seen this in the writing world where many agents are saying, just give us a story about people having fun. But for some reason in Hollywood, that always translates to black trauma. Make it about race, make it about black people being oppressed, make it about black people suffering. And many black people, it's not that there isn't a place for this kind of narrative, but these are almost always the only narratives we get. I made a decision early into my writing life to not write what I see as sociological stories. It's not that I ignore things about racism and trauma and all that stuff. It's just for me, I would rather it not be the driving force of my story, and I would rather it exists almost, dare I say it, allegorically. You can read into it, but at the end of the day, what I set out to do is tell a fascinating story. I want to be a storyteller, and I want to tell good stories, and it just so happens that my stories have at their helm black people. Stories where it's about black pain and suffering and racism coming to get black people. And I'm not saying there isn't a place for this. I would just rather it not be in speculative fiction. At least that's not the purpose of speculative fiction. I think I'm getting somewhere with this now. You know, I always take the long road to get to my points, but in science fiction and fantasy and horror, speculative fiction collectively, real world horrors had a place. They were just treated allegorically. Again, instead of black, we get a random alien race. We didn't get Tulsa Massacre, we got a massacre on a Xunazoma colony in a galaxy far, far away. And this worked because this is how science fiction has always worked. It takes us to an alien world with alien peoples, and it tells our stories through their eyes and through their lives. What we're getting in racialized horror is where that's not the case anymore. There are elements of science fiction and fantasy, but the story being told is very real world horror. So it's black people being tormented for being black. It's Tulsa Massacre incorporated into the narrative. It's not Tulsa Massacre disguised as a massacre in Oolalula colony in a galaxy far, far away. It's Tulsa, real world Tulsa. And this is not what we wanted. We fought against, we've complained about all these oppression narratives coming out of Hollywood. And now, what's been happening over the past 5 years is that these narratives are now being pushed under the banner of science fiction and fantasy. And, well, they're not allegorical at all anymore, but they're being called science fiction and fantasy, but they're not allegorical at all. The allegorical aspects of them have been stripped, and they're flat out exactly the same thing. So Antebellum is not very different from, say, 12 Years a Slave. Despite the twist, it's basically the same story, but it's being disguised as speculative fiction. And there is no allegory. There's no science fiction elements that disguises what it really is. So in a way, it's the real world racialized component that is dominant in these narratives, and the speculative science fiction aspects are just kind of not there. In the case of Lovecraft Country, it's a mixture of both prominently, but the speculative aspects can be basically ignored. because the real world racialized aspects are so prominently featured that it kind of takes away from the speculative aspects of it. And that's not what we as speculative fans and writers care for. You can disagree with me, but I just think that I would rather Black racialized trauma not pass itself off as speculative fiction. I saw Spell, and Spell is, it had the potential to be another racialized horror, but it was not. Thank goodness. It was a real speculative fiction horror story with Black people, which is what I want. It's not, let's take Black racial trauma and make it into the horror while disguising it as speculative fiction. It was real speculative fiction with Black people. So I really appreciated that. I'm not saying the movie was great. I'm just saying I appreciated that it wasn't disguising Black racialized horror as speculative fiction. But anyway, you can let me know what you think about this. This has been my take on racialized horror. I'm just saying, I love Watchmen. At the end of the day, the story itself should be the most important thing. And once the story has been told, then you can add little elements here and there. But please don't try to disguise real life Black racialized horror as speculative fiction. I, Janelle Monáe, I love you, girl, but Antebellum was just not what I was here for. His House, a good movie, but anyway, this has been Mel. Please don't forget to subscribe to my channel. Please give me a thumbs up, and please let your friends and family and associates know about me and this channel. And yeah, until next time, this has been my rant. I mean take. I mean analysis. Subscribe, folks. See you next time.